Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to present the topic today: integrating classical Ayurveda with modern pathological and biomedical understanding for improving the efficacy and management of polycystic ovarian syndrome associated infertility. Polycystic ovarian syndrome is one of the most common causes of menstrual disorders like amenorrhea, anovulation, cryptomenorrhea, and for female infertility. It is characterized by the appearance of multiple small cysts in the ovary, as we all know. It's also associated with a number of other complications. It's responsible for endometrial hyperplasia and endometrial cancer, for miscarriages in a number of patients, hirsutism and acne, fibroadenoma of the breast, insulin resistance in type 2 diabetes, high blood pressure, particularly in obese patients, and during pregnancy, in depression and depression with anxiety. It's also a high risk factor for dyslipidemia, cardiovascular diseases, stroke, sleep apnea in obese patients, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. I mean, the whole spectrum, most of these diseases would come under the metabolic syndrome. Acanthosis, diabetes, and autoimmune thyroiditis. Very often these conditions are not just comorbidities, they are also caused by the polycystic ovarian syndrome. I think I skipped a few slides. Right. We all know and we will encounter polycystic ovarian disease in our classical Ayurvedic clinics, and the approach that has been adopted generally is one of Shodhan Chikitsa, which is presided and preceded as is recommended in the textbooks by Sneha, with Girdas like Mahakalyana Dhritam, Sukumara Dhritam, Dadivari Dhritam, etc., which is followed by Svedana and the procedures of Vamana, Virechana, Astrabhana. The results that we obtained from this are quite interesting, because many patients respond to either Shamana alone. There are a number of patients who would respond just to Shamana Chikitsa, or combinations of both, Shamana and Shodhana Chikitsa. And generally, so we are all very happy with the success that we get from this. But however, I mean, we see response in terms of these issues. One is the regularization of periods, and there is a segment of patients who conceive naturally with this process of treatment that we adopt. However, I would try to address the other section of those patients who are not responding to this approach, and that's where I'm trying to focus my attention to. The concerns here are that not a very high rate of success. We have examples of quite a few patients who have succeeded. But on the other hand, we do have a larger number of patients who have not been successful through this protocol of regular Shodhana Chikitsa or Shamana Chikitsa alone. So my focus is only on that segment. Further, this approach has got a particular problem in that there is a difficulty in predicting the prognosis of an individual case. Third, we have to wait for a considerable period of time to evaluate the response in order to modify treatment protocol. For example, if you are addressing the difficulty in the menstruation, we have to wait for quite a few cycles before we can decide whether our approach is going in the right direction or not. That at least is relatively easier, but if you are talking about infertility, you generally tend to wait 7-8 months, and if nothing happens, then you have to redesign your strategy. You only know whether you are successful or not only after a number of months, which is a problem both with the doctor as well as with the patient. Is there a solution to these issues was the question I put to myself, and that's where I got some of these possible ideas. And it is in this context that we have been able to use modern diagnostics and biochemical basis of understanding of the disease to help improve the response rate. It's not a better response rate because the previous medicine was not good and this is better. But it's a better response rate because we are able to further subclassify those cases. And we can target specific underlying causes with specific medication.
and our ability to objectively measure improvement, though the patient may not be fully cured, you know that you are in the right direction if you can get hold of some objective parameters which you keep tracking time after time. Here is where this understanding dramatically improved the success that we started seeing in our clinic. The primary causes, so the understanding, a modern understanding of the etiology and the pathogenesis becomes the most important input that we could get from the modern side. Understanding the primary causes as described in modern literature, the most important cause is the genetical predisposition. There is a strong evidence that it is a genetic disease. The genetic component appears to be inherited in an autosomal dominant fashion. And so, about 50% of the daughters of a polycystic ovarian patients are likely to suffer from polycystic ovarian disease. Lifestyle related. Today we know that this is the hallmark of the population, and that's why the incidence of polycystic ovarian disease is rampantly growing. A very high glycemic and high fat diet, inadequate physical activity and chronic stress are all factors that lead to an imbalance in the hormonal system, which in turn leads to one or two polycystic ovarian disease. Now more specifically, this is something which is again more general, you can't do much about the genetical disease, and in any case, even in our classical approach, we do approach the lifestyle related issues. But when it comes to medication, the next set of secondary causes, which are very well measurable, give us the best, most important lead. The four major causes identified for polycystic ovarian disease are, number one, hyperinsulinemia, which is a characteristic of insulin resistance, hypothyroidism, hyperprolactinemia, and high androgens, as is evidenced by DHEAS or dihydroxyethylandrosteronidione, and excessive testosterone levels in the serum of patients suffering from polycystic ovarian syndrome. Not all patients have all these symptoms. In fact, no patient has all these different things upset. So different sets of patients have different factors in aberration in them. So these are four different types of polycystic ovarian disease patients. And our approach to treatment has to be different in all the four cases. If you look at the pathogenesis, polycystic ovaries develop when the ovaries are stimulated to produce excessive amounts of androgens or estrogen by either one or a combination of the following. One is a disruption of GnRH synthesis and release due to chronic stress. Increased levels of insulin in the blood, which is hyperinsulinemia, as a result of inadequate physical activity and consumption of high glycemic and high fat diet. So in the initial stages, in a pre-diabetic situation, the patient does not have diabetes, but he is actually controlling his blood sugar by producing excessive insulin. That is the stage which is conducive to the production of polycystic ovarian syndrome. So it is characterized by hyperinsulinemia rather than by hyperglycemia. The release of excessive LH by the anterior pituitary gland, resulting in the imbalance of the FSH-LH ratio. That is a characteristic feature in polycystic ovarian disease, and that is what leads to anovulation. Increased production of estrogen, which is characteristic, that is the cause of several symptoms that a patient with polycystic ovarian syndrome suffers from. And alternatively, or as well, reduced levels of sex hormone binding globulin, resulting in increased free androgens. What are the treatment goals? So now, understanding that the etiology and pathogenesis comprises of these steps, we are trying to address the problem through these different mechanisms. So what are we trying to achieve? Sometimes you get patients with polycystic ovarian disease coming to us complaining of primary infertility, where our goal is to achieve fertility. Whereas in several other cases where they have already conceived, but later they have developed polycystic ovarian syndrome, your goal could be restoration of normal regular menstruation. And in cases where of infertility, most often they have this problem of anovulatory cycles. So getting them to ovulate is one of the most important targets in the treatment. And most importantly, the ultimate is restoration of fertility. Treatment of hirsutism and acne present another challenge in the polycystic ovarian disease patients. And very important point is the prevention of endometrial hyperplasia and endometrial cancer. Because when they don't have a menstruation, a patient can do very well with a delay of up to 3 months. But if they don't menstruate beyond 3 months, the endometrial thickening becomes very thick, and that can lead to a higher disposition for endometrial cancer. So the additional considerations which we could draw from this understanding and incorporate into the Ayurvedic treatment protocol comprises of the following. One, to correct the central axis. As we all know, the master gland is the pituitary, which is in turn controlled by the hypothalamus, which in turn is controlled by the cerebral cortex. So if that is upset, as in the case of chronic stress, the GnRH, which is the first step in the process of the control of the hypothalamus by the cortex, GnRH is upset, and we are able to find excellent improvement in that condition by the use of Mahakalyanaka Gritham. Mahakalyanakam, we all know, his primary indication is for mental diseases, but it is clearly mentioned in Kalyanaka Gritham, Arethasi Alparethasi. It is absolutely spot on, it is absolute molecular biology. Because it improves GnRH secretion, and thereby it improves pituitary function, which in turn corrects the ovarian function, leading to normal ovulation over a period of time. However, if the patient has got insulin resistance as a basic cause of the problem, he will not respond with just Mahakalyanaka Gritham, because the problem is at the ovarian level, it is not at the cerebral level. You need a different approach, as if you are treating a patient of Prameha or diabetes. I mean, again, Prameha does not includes many, many more diseases other than diabetes. So I would put it as, you need to treat him as if you are treating for diabetes. So all the Kabhaja Prameha Hara Kwathas, like just some examples I have given, Kathakadiradi or Nishakadagadi Kwatha, along with anti-hyperglycemic. So I use this very specific term, anti-hyperglycemic, because most of our Ayurvedic medicines for diabetes are anti-hyperglycemic. They are not oral hypoglycemic agents. None of our products produce hypoglycemia. So the anti-hyperglycemic products that we have in Ayurveda are excellent in handling this condition. And so are our anti-lipidemic gudgulu related gudika kalpanas. Nishamalakyadi churnam is a very good addition to this concept. One, it improves the satiety. It is also a very high form of insoluble fiber, which slows down glucose absorption. And third, it also has an alpha amylase, an alpha, I don't get that hormone. Anyway, there is one more enzyme that it inhibits in the intestine, which slows down the absorption of carbohydrate, leading to better slow release of glucose into the bloodstream, which doesn't necessitate more production of insulin. So it's able to control the need for extra insulin in the body, and thereby the patient start recovering. Third, if they have got hypothyroidism, unless we address hypothyroidism, they are not going to respond. Kanjanara Gugulu and several other Gugulu Kalpanas and many of our traditional products, I would believe, provide a supportive therapy in that case. From my experience, it's only the patients who just need about 25 micrograms of thyroxine, they are able to respond with only our medicine. But most other cases who need 50 or upward of thyroxine, need thyroxine substitution if they have to get back into normalization. Third is, if they have got hyperestrogenism and hyperandrogenism, that's where modern medicine is really stuck. And that's where I think we are the strongest. This and central axis, these are the two areas where we are extremely strong. So people who have got hyperestrogenism, from my experience, they respond wonderfully to Sugumaram Kashayam. I'm not suggesting that their hirsutism reverses completely, but for that, most other symptoms of hyperestrogenism respond wonderfully to treatment with Sugumaram Kashayam. Hyperprolactinemia is another cause of polycystic ovarian disease. So testing for prolactin is one of the routine workups we should do in a patient with polycystic ovarian syndrome. It's not very common, but it's not very rare either. And from my experience, the least effective part of polycystic ovarian disease in our practice is those with hyperprolactinemia. I find the need to combine allopathic medication, which comprises of drugs like bromocriptine or cabergoline, to control that excessive secretion of prolactin, which in turn helps the ovary to recover fully. And chronic stress, of course, is another very, very important cause of polycystic ovarian disease. And we all know that's the most strong area for us. We have a whole range of anxiolytics and adaptogens in the form of Methi Drivyas and classical Ayurvedic relaxing therapies like Abhyanga, Shirodhara and so on, which are highly effective in combating the effect of chronic stress. The combination of all these procedures, we are able to see dramatic results in the form of the following. Most patients with polycystic ovarian syndrome with associated hyperinsulinemia get into normal ovulatory cycles with resolution, complete resolution of the polycystic appearance of the ovary, and they conceive within 6 to 8 months of therapy with holistic Ayurvedic intervention. When I mean holistic Ayurvedic intervention, I talk about our medicines as well as dietary as well as lifestyle modification, including aerobic exercise. Hypothyroidic patients respond wonderfully to Ayurvedic treatment along with thyroxine substitution. Chronic stress responds completely to Ayurvedic intervention. Increased DHEAS with associated hirsutism and hyperprolactinemia are the toughest to resolve. Thank you.
Polycystic disease is a disease of rasava srotasa vikruti predominantly. And being a rasava srotasa kapha pradhana, why not we should apply vamana therapy in polycystic disease?
I would not subscribe to the concept that it is only rasava srotasa vikara. It is multi-pronged. In rasava srotasa vikara, as is evidenced by a kapha pradhana anubandha, vamana is a very important treatment. I have mentioned that upfront that most of us do that. We understand it is kapha pradhana, then we do lankana jigitsa anyway. That is common. As all Ayurvedic doctors, I didn't want to go into details of that because we all know that. If you see kapha, you have to do lankana, you have to do sodhana, the most important is vamana. I mentioned that, but I didn't elaborate on it because we already know that. In spite of just doing all that, still they don't respond if you don't take care of the specific. We just treat kapha, not all diabetic patients recover. You have to have specific anti-diabetic drugs. You know, the prabhava of the drivya. We are using the other gunas like leghu, ruksha, all that is used. But all leghu, ruksha, drivyas do not control diabetes. You need prameha, hara, property. So similarly, that is where I am trying to, that is a fine tuning. So fundamental is to see that you don't use a snigdha, you don't use a guru. So those you have to avoid. You have to use between this, within this what do you choose? In what condition do you choose the specific drug? That is what I
have tried to project.
I hope I am clear.
Sir, whether in hyperthyroidism and hypothyroidism, whether Kanchanaro, Gugulo are both effective in both the conditions. Kanchana Gugulo is effective in both hyper and hypothyroidism. Any experience, any practical experience, please share with us.
I have very limited experience in treating patients with hyperthyroidism. But from what I have seen, I find a more of a pittahara sort of an approach to be more appropriate in hyperthyroidism and a kapahara approach to be more appropriate in hypothyroidism. So I wouldn't try Kanchanara Gugulu as a first line of therapy, but I don't think Kanchanara is a bad choice as an additive. You may have to do the pittahara chikitsa, but also combine, because it has got specific effect on the neck region, which I appreciate very well. And it has got an anti-tumor sort of an activity. So from that perspective, hyperthyroidism with the nodular goiter may respond to some extent, but symptomatically they definitely need additional drugs. I treated a few patients, but they were all already on allopathic drugs and carbamazine. They were already on that, and I was not able to withdraw that. I have to admit that.
Should we think only anuvasana basti with dhanvantara taila maru? Should we apply yoga bastis?
Never is basti to be done. Only anuvasana or only asthapana is never recommended. If you have to do more number of anuvasanas, you definitely have to have asthapana in between. So there is no question of only doing anuvasanavasti. That's the concept. So if you do continuously do anuvasana, there will be agnivatha, utklesha agnivatha, snehal, niruhal, maritobhayam. You can't do either of them exclusively. You have to. That is why yogavasti is a standard protocol. If you want to give 8, you do yogavasti. If you want to do more, kalavasti or karmavasti. But according to me, the single tilting factor is the snehabana with Mahakalyana Dhritam. Almost in every single case which has been absolutely resistant to treatment, when we do a full-fledged snehabana with Mahakalyanagam, we have seen the patient starts menstruating. It's much more effective than Raja Pravartana Vidhi or Kulathari Kashayam or every sort of kashayams or medicine, other medicines that I have tried. And I can share the personal experience of a patient who did not have periods for 8 years. Only if she takes progesterone, withdrawal bleeding will happen. Otherwise, she is just not menstruating. And that girl, for the first time in her life, she got her periods with the Snehavana of Mahalyana. Thereafter, of course, she conceived and she got a baby. She just did not have any hope. But I will also say, I have also encountered patients who, despite everything that I have mentioned, I am still not been able to break the ground. I have referred that patient to Dr. Anand Mohan now, and then we are planning to work on her together. I mean, we have our limitations, we have our strengths. I think we should focus on our strengths and move forward and be ready to accept. At this stage, okay, beyond this, I seem to be helpless. Why don't we use the support from others? I mean, I would also like to say that I have had a case where the entire polycystic tendency completely reversed, but she did not conceive. So what I did was, I started administering clomiphene citrate along with that. It's an allopathic protocol. From day 3 to day, that is for 5 days, from day 3 you start clomiphene citrate or letrozole or something. So those sort of drugs if you use, they generally say that you expect a success within 6 months. No use using that further. So we can use allopathic protocols side by side with our treatment. We can even improve the success rate of an IVF. I find so many patients who come to us who have had 5 sessions of IVF and they are failing. I tell them, because basically your micromilieu is not corrected. You are simply trying to fix something in a wrong place. It will not get fixed. So you correct your milieu, and sometimes we may not be able to still break through. You may still, because his sperm count, his viability may be poor. Okay, there also we have effective treatments. We are able to give very good response to, you know, azoospermia, not to azoospermia, asthenospermia and keratozoospermia. We are quite effective. But it's not uniform in every case. There are some non-responders. There are people who need IVF and who will be successful with IVF. If we do that together, I think our success rate will be far higher than they alone or we alone doing it. That's my message.
So I have 2 questions. One is, what would be your Ayurvedic diagnosis? Would you be call it as Abhyantara Granthi or Vidradhi in the case of PCOD? Or will you go in more like Arajaska, or will you, what would be your diagnosis? And one more question, sir. Would you try nasyas in conditions of central axis problems?
One, very often I don't try to ascribe an Ayurvedic disease diagnosis to most of my conditions. If I get a diagnosis from any system of medicine, I'm happy with that. I need to know what the disease is, what is my target, and how am I going to attack that. There are many diseases which have very clear allopathic diagnosis. There are many diseases which have absolutely no clear allopathic diagnosis. I think we are extremely strong when there is no allopathic diagnosis. He has a problem here, he has a, so it's a systemic problem for which you will have to list 10 different diseases from the allopathic system. That's where the Ayurvedic diagnosis is the best. You have to write a passage for the diagnosis. You will say that Abhanavayu has got upset here, it went there and upsetted this Vayu or this Kapha, and then that has gone and upsetted this. This is the Ayurvedic diagnosis I tried to arrive at. And then you correct that pathophysiology, then you are fine. So I don't try to ascribe names to that. Second question is, I have not tried Nasya. I generally, because I practice more in Tamil Nadu, which is not very receptive to Panchakarma procedures. They are extremely expecting Ayurveda to be like allopathic medicine. They come to your clinic and expect you to give some medicines. So I try Shamana Chikitsa first and foremost. And if there is a failure, my general next option is to go for classical Panchakarma. But the main focus I give to is to Snehabhara. I have really not done Nasya in most of these cases because I didn't find failure in the central axis correction with that procedure itself. It all succeeds. The problem is lying elsewhere. If they have got hirsutism, they have got high androgens. That is where we are failing. So that is where we are getting stuck.
My first question was because using some formulations like Varanadi or something, which is Varanadi like formulations, which is acting on Vidrati, etc., would it also help?
Yes, I agree with you, because it is that feeling that triggers the use of Varanadi. Of course, it is a Vataka Pagna. So that concept of looking at it as a Granthi is there internally, but I don't try to give a diagnosis to that. Because if you just look at it as a Granthi, it is not a Granthi. It is not a Granthi in the typical understanding of Granthi, but Varanadi does have an effect here. Including in the cases of ovarian fibroids and all that. Varanadi is an additive, but that alone does not help. Unless, for me, the most important medicine in the process is Sugumaram. Because you need to keep your estrogen level under control. So with Sugumaram, what are the different things that you add is what really brings out the speciality. I found, this is my hypothesis, I have not tested to establish that Sugumaram is exactly anti-estrogenic, but it is derived from finding that all diseases that arise out of excess estrogen are responding beautifully to the use of Sugumaram. So I assume it has got in some way, I don't know the molecular pathway, but I'm planning really a research on that to study the mechanism of action, and once it is out, I would be happy to publish that.